There were also displays of a paper phoenix, a giant paper tulip, and a few mock castles also made out of paper. It seems that until the 18th century, no documentation regarding those craftsmen, you know, anybody who was involved in you know, some kind of a trade dealing with paper was archived. And this is very un-Ottoman, and their presence did not find its way into narrative sources either, and this is very typically Ottoman. A reference in the rare mid-17th century text on the treatment of paper, however, giving recipes for dyeing paper, sizing and burnishing, testifies that there was a certain kind called Istanbuli. It was Nefesade İbrahim's Güzar-ı Savab, which among several kinds of paste for sizing, recommends a specific kind for the Istanbuli papers. The aforementioned paste, he says, referring to a recipe recommended for Sultani and Samarkandi papers, these are both from Samarkand, should be combined with a quantity of fish glue and applied two or three times on the Istanbuli paper with the palm of the hand as described. So one wonders whether it was the glaze applied to those papers in Istanbul that made to be identified as Istanbuli. And around the same time as the Güzar-ı Savab, registers of price control in Istanbul reveal information about the kinds and prices of paper available on the market. In the 1640 register of retail price control, several types of both Eastern and Western papers were listed. Sultani and Abadi, again, one from Samarkand, the other from India, Devlet-Abad, the most expensive ones, are the only Eastern papers, while I, literally meaning moon, and Alem, Yangalı, and Alem, literally in Ottoman Turkish, means standard, were the European papers with watermarks. This Alem, as far as I can tell, stands for various combinations of crescents and crowns, while moon, the crescent, happens to be the trilune, which frequently appear, you know, in most of our, you know, primary sources. In 1640, Haşebi, paper made of wood fiber, and Şapta, perhaps an import from the Andalusian city of Şatiba, or Yativa, and Istanbuli, were the cheapest to be found in the Istanbul market, but they were never identified as watermarked. It's known that while European manufacturers used symbols approvable in the East, hence we have various formulations and patterns of the trilune, Ottoman manufacturers might have imitated the watermarks of the European papers for numerous reasons. One of my highs was, and still is, the absence of the three crescents in a row in the celebrated filigranologist Briquet's 1907 Le Filigran, a monumental four-volume catalog of more than 16,000 watermarks, which I can only hope proves its being a symbol used in local Istanbul manufactories. But without material analysis, even watermarks alone might be misleading. A well-seasoned historian noted the extensive uses of Istanbuli in various administrative offices in the capital, together with the aforementioned Haşebi and papers known as Telhislik and Fıstıki. The telhis were outlines written by the vizier summarizing documents on matters to be submitted to the consideration and decision of the sultan. Some of these were written on very small papers. Hence, telhislik seemed to refer to small size papers, whereas battal was a medium size paper. Among the papers submitted by the chief of the guild of paper dealers to various administrative offices, at first glance, terms like telhislik, battal, and Istanbul seemed to refer to the sizes of paper. But Istanbul paper was available in three sizes, also identified as battal and telhislik, that's to say medium and small, as well as large. The 1726 Code of Regulations on the duties of paper dealers and burnishers lists watermark papers with no size specifications, but identifies only the Istanbul paper as large and medium, together with Shabata paper imported from Spain. A cheaper group included üç takyeli, three hats, again a Western import, medium Istanbul, and green-colored Istanbul, fıstık or fıstıki, telhis paper. There are also references to improved ıslah Istanbul paper. So I can go on and on and on, but such data, even tediously collected and tabulated, as I have been trying to do, do not take us anywhere about the production processes. Materials, practices, and networks of people involved still remain in the dark. So what kind of paper was Istanbul or ıslah Istanbul'di? At the moment, I cannot even tell whether Istanbul fıstığı was a fine or regular kind of import paper or a local product, whether it was greenish or brownish. That's to say named after pistachio or peanut. And fıstıki came in different colors. It has to be greenish or brownish, but it comes in white, in blue, or sugar candy pink. Can it be more puzzling? It seems that despite our best efforts, those interested in Ottoman paper often found themselves back at square zero, and only the 19th century Istanbul production can be proved through papers bearing the watermark Istanbul 1219, that's to say 1804, 1805. I will conclude, however, on a positive note, highlighting the most promising kind of archival evidence towards paper production in Istanbul. It's the Ahkam Şikayet, verdicts and complaints registers of the city, which record a wealth of documentation, which I intend to explore, regarding the state, the guild, and the crowds of people involved in various paper trades. There's still a catch, though. These registers are only available after 1742. However, the identification of issues concerning the complaints made to the Ottoman Divan, which served as the Supreme Court, and related solutions and verdicts may pave the way for several other archival collections to uncover the pre-1742 practices. Thank you for listening.